Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The First Lady and the Rebel, a novel by Susan Higginbotham, narrated by Tiffany Morgan. Chapter 1. Mary. October 1839 to November 4th, 1842. The man she intended to marry had yet to learn about their future together, but she had already made up her mind. It was a pity, though, that she had been so bedraggled when they first saw each other shortly after Mary arrived at her married sister Elizabeth's house to pay an extended visit of the sort that was hoped by families to end in matrimony for the unmarried sister, and quite often did. The trip from Mary's home in Lexington, Kentucky, to Elizabeth's in Springfield, Illinois, had taken over 2 weeks and had involved nearly every means of transport known to man— rail, boat, coach, and even a stretch on foot when the coach hit a muddy patch. Mary had arrived at her sister's house tired and out of sorts and eager to take a nap and freshen up. Instead, she had found that Elizabeth, whose house drew anyone of any importance in Springfield, had company. Their cousin, John Todd Stewart, and his law partner. So, a roomful of lawyers, who could be either the dullest people in existence or the most fascinating, depending on what they chose to speak about. Hoping for the latter, Mary had repaired her coach-worn appearance as best she could and entered the room. "Cousin!" John Stewart kissed her cheek, then shook hands with her father, who had been her escort on the journey.
"We were just leaving, and I'm sure you're glad of it after your long trip. We'll stop by once you're settled in. You didn't meet Mr. Lincoln here on your last visit, did you?"
"No," Mary said. She gazed at the stranger in the room, a man of about 30 years of age who somewhat awkwardly extended his hand to her. "I would have remembered Mr. Lincoln." He was certainly not a forgettable person. He was tall, well over 6 feet, a trait that Mary, at 5'2", usually found off-putting in a man. With this man, however, she scarcely cared that she had to tip her head up to look at him, for his face, sharp-edged and topped by a thatch of ill-tamed black hair, was well worth the effort. It was not a handsome face by any means, but after years of enduring the good-looking and vacuous young men of Lexington, Mary had concluded long ago that handsomeness was overrated. This man had character in his face. Character and intelligence. She had never seen the like. But she could not simply stand there staring at Mr. Lincoln as if she were a practitioner of physiognomy. "I have heard of you, Mr. Lincoln, many times. Weren't you the leader of the effort to get the state capitol moved here?"
Ninian Edwards, Mary's brother-in-law, broke in before Mr. Lincoln, who had appeared at a loss for what to do after releasing Mary's hand, could reply.
"Miss Todd will talk politics like a man if you allow her."
"Why, yes, I will," said Mary. "It is unladylike, I grant you, but if we feel the effects of politics as much, if not more so, than you gentlemen, shall we not be allowed to take an interest in such a weighty subject? But you have not allowed Mr. Lincoln to answer my question, Brother Ninian."
"It was the work of many, Miss Todd,"
Mr. Lincoln said. His voice was not deep, as Mary had expected, but peculiarly high-pitched, though Mary, on reflection, found it not to be displeasing. "But we have to be off, as Mr. Stewart says."
"Well," said Mary, "those many should be quite pleased with themselves, for Springfield has improved very much since I was here last. I expect it will be a regular metropolis when I next visit."
Mr. Lincoln nodded, then all but fled from the Edwards's parlor.
"You quite overwhelmed the man," her sister Elizabeth said as she showed Mary to her room a little while later. "He scarcely says boo to us women in Springfield who have known him for some time, much less a complete stranger."
"I find him fascinating." Mary began to unpack her trunk. In Lexington, a slave would already have accomplished that task, but it was clear that in Springfield, she would have to fend for herself.
5, 6 words, and you find him fascinating?"
"He has a mind, Elizabeth. I can tell that." Oh, man, Elizabeth snorted. Well, he needs that, because he certainly does not have breeding. Did you not see how he was dressed? He must throw his clothes on in the pitch darkness. I was not looking at his dress. I hope he comes back here soon so I can. He will. He's here quite often. But if you want to hold a conversation with him, you'll need to be prepared to do the talking yourself, if you're a woman, at least. With the men, he can tell stories and idle time away for hours. But tell me, how is everyone at home? Oh, the same. Our stepmother sends us her kindest regards, not to mention her vast relief at having one less stepdaughter to plague her. Anne is trying as ever, although she cheered up marvelously when I left upon finally getting to claim our room as hers. The little ones are driving Mammy Sally to distraction, and the baby is squalling as loud as he ever was. Levi's habits do not improve. Somewhat awkwardly, Mary shook out the gown she had just removed from her trunk. Oh, and Emily was nearly kidnapped. The mite wandered off, probably as tired of the baby squalling as the rest of us, and a passing couple was so taken with her beauty, they took her home and kept her there until their minister happened to come by and impressed upon them that they were doing wrong. She is a lovely little thing. Settling her chemises into a drawer, Mary asked in her most casual tone, "When do you think Mr. Lincoln will call?" "Soon," said Elizabeth firmly. "Now, go lie down. You must be exhausted. Probably Mr. Lincoln won't appear nearly as fascinating to you when you've had some rest." Mary sighed, but did not argue. She looked around the room, which had been occupied by her second oldest sister, Frances, until her marriage just a few months before, and saw that her bed had been turned down, but not with much care. White servants, who she had learned from Elizabeth tended to do exactly as they pleased, would take some getting used to, just like the mud that filled the mostly unpaved streets of Springfield and that had slightly contaminated her dress despite her best efforts. The mattress she sank into was of excellent quality, as was everything in her sister's household. No surprise, since Ninian Edwards was a former governor's son, and his house, perched upon a hill at a slight distance from the heart of the town, was one of the best in Springfield. From her father, however, who told her everything, Mary had learned that all was not well with her brother-in-law, who was finding it hard to pay some of his bills. But the entire country had been in the doldrums due to the bank panic of 2 years before. Now that Springfield was the new capital, thanks in large part to this Mr. Lincoln, perhaps things would turn around for her brother-in-law. Her last visit to Springfield had been a short one, and had served its purpose well of allowing Mary to get a respite from a house full of half-siblings, all of whom had inherited the Todd temper in varying degrees, and her stepmother. Not that Mary was completely unsympathetic to Mrs. Todd, saddled with the task of raising the children from her husband's first marriage while bearing her own children at almost mechanical intervals. This visit was different. With Frances married, it was time for Mary, the next sister in line, to do the same, especially as she was nearly 21, by no means at the age where society would declare her doomed to spinsterhood, but still at a point of life where she had to be thinking of her prospects. She had utter confidence that she would find a husband, although it was true that suitors had not exactly been lining up by her father's study in Lexington. Mary had never given any of the men there a thought, much less any encouragement. She considered them shallow. No doubt they believed her to be peculiar, with her habit of saying what she thought and her unladylike interest in politics. But what did it matter? Springfield, small but pushing, was where her future lay. In Lexington, men lounged. In Springfield, they strove. Those were the sort of men that caught her fancy. And none of them, she suspected, strove as much as Mr. Lincoln. It was foolish for her to think, on such short acquaintance, that he was the husband for her. But while she didn't know him, she did know of him. She knew that her cousin, a fine lawyer, had taken him on as a junior partner, which he would hardly do if the man didn't have promise.
She knew that Mr. Lincoln had led the group of legislators who had battled to move the Illinois capital to Springfield, no mean undertaking considering how unpromising the city had looked just a couple of years ago. Even today, as Mary's stagecoach had pulled up alongside the new American House Hotel, a contingent of hogs had been near the door to greet the passengers. And while he might not have breeding, the fact that he was received in her brother-in-law's parlor showed that he had other qualities, for Ninian Edwards would not let just anyone into his fine house, and it had taken something to get in the legislature in the first place. What might such a man accomplish with her as a wife? Mary settled to sleep, smiling at the possibilities. But Mr. Lincoln did not come to the Edwards house the next day, nor the day afterward. Mary asked her sister and brother-in-law about him only once or twice, so not as to seem overly interested, but they could say little except that he was a busy man who did not socialize much in the evenings. She had plenty of time anyway, Mary thought. No point of rushing into these things. In the meantime, she visited her sister Frances, now Mrs. Wallace, who was boarding with her husband in the Globe Tavern. $4 a week bought the newlyweds a room, with meals included, and the cacophony of coaches coming and going. "Granted, it's not what I was accustomed to," Frances said, waving Mary to a seat in the corner that served as the couple's sitting room. "But it's better than I expected. I was in tears when Dr. Wallace told me we would be living in a boarding house." "I can see why," Mary admitted. The room was clean, with all the requisite furnishings, and Frances had been in it long enough to add some of her own touches. But the comforts that Mary and her sisters were accustomed to from their home in Lexington and their sister Elizabeth's home, a floor gleaming with polish, silver on the sideboards, servants within call, were missing. "Still, at least you don't have to cook or clean." Frances leaned forward. "Actually," she said in a low voice, "I do help out occasionally. There are so few women here at the moment, and I would be frightfully bored when Dr. Wallace is gone if I do not." "Goodness," Mary said. She was an expert seamstress, having decided some years ago to acquire the art of fine sewing rather than to trust others to emulate the fashion plates she so admired. But cooking and cleaning were tasks that she was quite happy to leave to the servants, white or black. She repressed a shudder. She had evidently not repressed it well enough, though, for Frances said, "Sister, if you marry a man like that Mr. Lincoln, you may find yourself doing such tasks." "Who said that I planned to marry him?" "Well, Elizabeth said you were interested, and you do have a way of getting what you set your mind on." "Fair enough. But I've only seen him once, and for all I know, he may not improve upon acquaintance." "He's agreeable enough," Frances said, almost coquettishly. "Why, do you know him?" Mary's eyes widened. "He did not court you, did he?" "No. Mr. Edwards spoke of him so much, I asked him to invite him over, and we walked out together once or twice. He appeared to enjoy my company, but he put forth no effort in putting our acquaintance on a higher level. And when Dr. Wallace took an interest in me, that was that." Mary nodded, concealing her inward sigh of relief. It would not have done to be the second Todd sister of choice. In December, the legislature met in Springfield for the first time, its members traveling by coach because the railway had not yet come to town, and meeting wherever a body of men could squeeze in because the Capitol building had yet to be completed. The pigs were no less intrusive, but they had to share the muddy streets now with the state's politicians. The legislators filled the American House, spilling over to the parlors of the Globe Tavern, where Frances found her slumbers sometimes being interrupted by the sound of brawling politicians. With the legislature had come the rain, which for days upon end alternated between downpours and drizzles, occasionally mixing with a few bedraggled snowflakes. Because venturing upon the streets would have been the ruination of their gowns and slippers, those ladies who could afford to stay inside did so, sending their servants to do their marketing.
Mary could not have endured this had she not found a new friend, Mercy Levering, who had come from Baltimore to stay with her brother, Larason Levering, who lived next door to the Edwardses. Mary took to Mercy instantly. The young women were of an age. Both were from more established cities than Springfield, although Mary had to cede Baltimore's superiority to Lexington in that respect, and both were from aristocratic families. Even better, Mercy had quickly acquired a suitor, a lawyer named James Conkling, and could safely appreciate Mr. Lincoln's virtues without aspiring to him herself. But even Mercy's company had begun to pale after a week of rain, and Mary was itching to get back to town. That was when Mary, having dashed from her house to Mercy's, spied a pile of shingles on the porch, left there, she supposed, by some workman. "Mercy, I have an idea. Remember how Sir Walter Raleigh spread his cloak for the Queen to cross over? Well, we haven't a knight, more's the pity, but we do have our own frontier way of managing." "Whatever do you mean?" Mary held up a shingle. She tossed it in front of her, then stepped primly onto it. "See? We'll throw the shingles down before us, and our feet will never touch the muck."
"You can't be serious."
"I most assuredly am. Can you seriously bear one more day cooped up inside?" Mary nodded in the direction of the pianoforte. "You can buy some more music," she said coaxingly. Mercy sighed, but she had been bemoaning the lack of new music just the day before. "Oh, I suppose, but if we catch a chill and die, I'll never forgive you." They grabbed a pile of shingles and set off on the short walk to town, Mary's face alight with adventure, Mercy straggling along as if being led to slaughter. For two or three blocks, the scheme worked well enough, but by the fourth block, the shingles were as muddy as the streets themselves, and more than one citizen leaned out of his or her window to stare at the spectacle of the two finely dressed young ladies hopping from one shingle to another. When they finally reached civilization, Monroe Street with its sidewalk and shops, they tossed their filthy shingles aside and rushed into a bookstore where Mary bought the latest novel and Mercy the latest song. By the time they exhausted the shops an hour or so later, a drizzle was replenishing the mud and the air had a chill. "I've had enough adventure for one day," Mercy said firmly as they left. "No more shingles. We can find my brother or Mr. Edwards to give us a ride home in his carriage."
"Or Mr. Conkling, but we'll have to wait until they leave their offices."
"That can't be helped."
"Wait!" Mary waved to a passing drayman. "Here's a way to get home."
"Mary, are you mad?"
"No, I'm cold and tired and want to get to the warmth of my parlor. Mr. Hart," she smiled at the drayman who tipped his hat, "will be delighted to be of service to us, won't you, dear sir?"
"Most certainly, Miss Todd."
Mercy picked up her skirts and fled.
"I'll stop by tomorrow," she called. "My brother would be furious if I got into that thing."
"What a rude word for such a fine dray," Mary said as Mr. Hart helped her as best he could into the vehicle. "Shall we be off, sir?" A collection of boys were gaping at her, and she majestically waved her hand as she fancied Queen Victoria must. "To home!" With a lurch that nearly sent her sprawling into the mud, Mr. Hart obliged. Capital city or not, Springfield was still a small, tittle-tattle town, even more so now that the legislators were here to add to the goings-on. So Mary was not entirely surprised to hear on Tuesday, a dry day with a strong wind, all the better to drive gossip from house to house, that her adventure on the dray was known to all and sundry, to the amusement of all, except for Elizabeth, whose steely silence indicated that she was in complete possession of the details.
"I didn't tell a soul," Mercy protested when Mary came over that afternoon.
"I wouldn't have needed to, though. Such a spectacle needed no help from me. And if there's a soul who doesn't know about it, the cotillion will remedy that."
"Cotillion?"
"Oh, yes. Some gentlemen are organizing a ball, as it's been so dreary, and the men are in need of civilizing. Why, Mr. Edwards is on the committee. Your sister said nothing to you?"
"Not a thing."
"Dear, you had best sweeten her up, then." Mercy could not help but smirk. especially since your Mr. Lincoln will be there, or I assume he will, as he is on the committee as well.
He will?
Mary rose. I must get a new gown.
Oh, I wouldn't bother. They say he never notices what women wear.
But, Mercy snickered, you might capture his attention if you arrive in your dray. Mary arrived at the American house on the day of the cotillion not in a dray, but in her brother-in-law's carriage. As the ladies in their finery hurried into the suite that had been converted into a dressing room for the occasion, Mary watched with amusement as the younger matrons, who had entered clutching squirming bundles to their chests, briskly nursed the contents of the bundles before they handled them off to the girls who had been hired to watch them for the evening. "Don't mix them up," they called as the girls spread out a line of sleeping babies on the bed. It would be pleasant to be married, but there was no need to rush into anything, she decided as she pinched some color into her cheeks. Goodness knew there were enough children back in her father's house in Lexington to look after if she were so minded. Following her sister into the ballroom, meekly, for Elizabeth was still silently indignant about the Dray incident, Mary admired the room, ablaze with candles and decked with greenery as a herald of the Christmas season. Standing by the doorway were the men who had organized the cotillion. Though Ninian and some of the others were tall men, one nonetheless towered over them. Mr. Lincoln. In his black suit, he was nattier than he had been when Mary had last met him. As did the other men, he greeted the ladies in turn as they filed into the room. Then he saw Mary. His face twisted into a grin. He slapped his knee and he began to laugh so hard he wheezed. Dray? He finally managed. A dray. There's Miss Todd, the girl who rode in a dray.
Yes.
Elizabeth said freezingly, that is my sister, who rode in a dray. Come along, Mary. But Mr. Lincoln would have none of it. He straightened up and wiped his eyes. Funniest thing I ever saw, he gasped. There I was, making some notes at my desk, and who should I see coming down the street but Miss Mary Todd in all her fine feathers, riding in that dray. I tell you, it made my day, Miss Todd. Made my week. Made my month. The finest sight I've ever seen in Springfield. Miss Todd, I want to dance with you in the worst way. Will you oblige? Unable to muster a reply, Mary handed him her dance card, and Mr. Lincoln neatly inscribed it. First on the list. I can't wait, Miss Todd. He did indeed, as Mary was fond of telling others in years to come, dance with her in the worst way. Mary had danced with awkward men and boys before, especially at Madame Mantille's school, where as a boarder she had helped her teacher's sons learn the Terpsichorean art, but she could not keep her slippers clear of Mr. Lincoln's enormous feet. This was so even though Mr. Lincoln was more focused on his feet than on Mary, who wondered wistfully if he even noticed her new gown, sprigged with blue flowers that matched her eyes or the very becoming arrangement of her thick, dark hair. Though she had had little patience when the swains of Lexington paid her their empty, trite compliments, she would not have taken such pretty phrases amiss coming from Mr. Lincoln. But even if Mr. Lincoln was inclined to give her such tributes, they had had no chance for conversation, because even if the dance had lent itself to it, talking and dancing simultaneously was completely beyond her partner's powers. So she had to settle for the pleasant sensation of his large hand clasping hers as she twirled around whenever her partner remembered to let her do so. Mr. Lincoln seemed pleased enough with his performance, however. After all, Mary was still standing and had all 10 toes intact, and managed a gallant bow as the number ended. He would have lingered by Mary's side to talk after she limped off the dance floor, but Mary, knowing the proprieties of such matters, and finding that Elizabeth had only just begun to thaw after the Dray incident, gently reminded him that she was engaged for the next dance, and several thereafter. Yet when she was claimed by her next partner, Mr. Stephen Douglas, who danced so well that Mary scarcely noticed his almost comically small stature, Mary found herself looking around the room for Mr. Lincoln. It was almost worth hazarding her slippers once more. Though Mr. Lincoln had not paid much attention to her gown, which so enticingly displayed her shoulders and a hint of bosom, the other bachelors in the room apparently did, so Mary was engaged for the entire evening. As this was her first ball in Springfield, normally she would have been gratified by this, but her mind was on Mr. Lincoln, and when she could manage it discreetly, her eyes as well. She was able to learn through her observations that he did not drink, though he made no point of his abstemiousness but stood laughing amid his companions, some of whom had clearly overindulged in spirits. This pleased Mary. Though no Kentucky girl expected men to avoid liquor entirely, she disliked drunkenness. If she shared any trait of her stepmother's, it was the way they both watched her brother Levi anxiously at gatherings, counting his drinks and praying that he would not pass beyond the stage of amiable intoxication. Mr. Lincoln was not dressed badly, although his sleeves and pantaloons were a bit too short, and there was nothing in the cut of his garment to recommend his tailor. What a proper wife could do for him in that regard. Elizabeth glided behind her, nearly causing her to drop the cup of punch she held. "Do stop staring at Mr. Lincoln," she hissed in French, continuing a habit the sisters had found useful on a number of occasions. "If it makes you feel better, though, he has asked to call tomorrow, and I have granted his wish. You may gaze at him all you like then." Mr. Lincoln bounded into the parlor the next afternoon, on time, and not showing any signs of fatigue or dissipation, although the cotillion had still been going on when Mary and the Edwardses had left in the small hours. When he had taken his seat on a horsehair sofa beside Mary, she said, "Now, Mr. Lincoln, you really must tell me all the ins and outs of how you moved the legislature to Springfield. There is ample time for it today, and I insist."
"I will obey, Miss Todd, but tell me, what got you interested in politics?"
"Goodness, Mr. Lincoln, I hardly know. It almost seems as if I have always been. But if I had to assign a cause, and if you ask, I must." Mary smiled in a manner she knew would show a dimple. "My mother died when I was quite young, and I felt the loss very keenly. You know how a parent wishes to indulge a child in such a situation."
"Well, no," Mr. Lincoln said dryly.
"A girl child, then, Mr. Lincoln. In any case, I liked to sit with my father when he was at home, and he would allow me to remain in the room for an hour or two while he talked to his friends, on the condition that I remained absolutely quiet. Naturally, their conversations would turn to politics, and as I could do nothing but listen, I did, and learned a great deal. And what great men I had to learn from, Henry Clay among them."
"Henry Clay? Why, he is my hero, Miss Todd, and you know him."
"Indeed, she does," Elizabeth, who had been knitting on the matching sofa across the room, put in. "Why, she made a perfect nuisance of herself one day at his house." "I did not. He was charmed." Mary glared at her sister, then turned to Mr. Lincoln. "When I was quite a young thing, you see, I took it in my head to ride my new pony to Ashland, his estate, and show it to him, who in the county was a better judge of horseflesh. Well, he was entertaining some gentlemen, but being the soul of courtesy, he kindly invited me in, and I had a simply delightful time listening to them. When there was an opening in the conversation, I did not interrupt, Elizabeth, as everyone insists. I told Mr. Clay that my father thought he, Mr. Clay that is, would someday be the president, and that I would dearly like to live in the White House myself." "I wonder what Mrs. Clay thought of that, sister." "Goodness, I wasn't proposing to marry Mr. Clay. That would be shocking. I was merely stating a fact. In any case, Mr. Clay assured me that if he were ever president, I would be one of his first guests. And as far as I know, the invitation still stands. So I took it downright personally when he lost the nomination this year." As Mary and Mr. Lincoln began bewailing Mr. Clay's loss, Elizabeth yawned once, then twice, and soon found an excuse to slip out of the room, leaving the pair to move to the subject of the relocation of the capital and, gradually, an inch or two closer together. They were still chattering away, or, to be precise, Mary was chattering and Mr. Lincoln was listening, when the sounds and smells of dinner being prepared began to intrude upon their conversation, followed by Elizabeth's reappearance. "Mr. Lincoln, we would be delighted to have you stay to dine with us."
"Thank you, Mrs. Edwards, but it's going to be a busy day tomorrow. Got to do a little work tonight."
He stole a look at Mary.
"I hope I might call again at this house."
"Of course," Elizabeth said. From that day on, Mr. Lincoln appeared at the Edwards' house every few days, taking the same place beside Mary. Sometimes they would talk politics. Other times they would take a book from Ninian Edwards' well-stocked, if not exactly well-thumbed, library and have one read it to the other. He knew far more about her than she did about him. All the scant details of his family she had garnered from others. His mother had died when he was young. He had not been exactly poor as a child, but had never been comfortable either. His father had moved from place to place, looking for a propitious place to settle, but never quite finding it. Like Mary, he was a Kentuckian, but the log cabin of his birth might have been separated from the gracious house of Mary's birth by an ocean. He had started out doing manual labor and had somehow wandered into New Salem, where he had blundered into co-owning a store which had foundered when his partner had died of drink. With some fellows from New Salem, he had served in the Black Hawk War, which, in a way, had been his making, for it had brought him into contact with Mary's cousin John Stewart, who had encouraged him to read the law and eventually had taken him on as a partner. And, in all that, he had found his way into politics. Anything more, she would have to pry out of him, she supposed. Were they courting? Goodness, she wasn't sure of even that. He had the regularity of a lover, for certain, but not the mannerisms of one. And while he sat as close to her on the sofa as her skirts would allow, that was the one liberty he took, if it could be called that. Not that she wanted him to behave in an ungentlemanly manner, but a kiss or even some hand-holding would have been welcome. She had consulted Mercy, her guide to all things involving courtship. Neither of her sisters would really do under the circumstances, and Mercy had agreed that something a little more should be happening. Why, her dear James had left her positively flustered the other day. Surely Mr. Lincoln didn't find her unattractive, did he? Mary looked at herself in the mirror critically. She would never credit herself with beauty, but with her perfect complexion and her bright blue eyes, there was certainly nothing in her face to make a man avert his. So far, most of their meetings had been in the Edwards' parlor, but not long after Christmas, the snow turned the rutted, homely streets into glistening white paths. Everyone on the hill, as the Edwards' neighborhood was called, bundled up and went for sleigh rides. As such things were done best seated in pairs, the single young men of the city were, of course, invited on these outings, and Mr. Lincoln, perhaps through Mercy's help, ended up being paired with Mary. The chill in the air allowed Mary to move a little closer to him without being forward, but that was the only progress they made, even though it would have been perfectly harmless for him to put his arm around her to keep her from falling out when the driver began to go a wee bit too fast. "Good, clean exercise," he had said when he handed her out, almost as an afterthought, for it was apparent that he had grown up around women who were used to doing for themselves. "Wasn't that fun, Miss Todd?" Mary, who had spent the entire ride holding her muff in a way that invited him to slip his hand inside to join hers, had been hard-pressed not to scowl. "Delightful." Then the legislature adjourned, and Springfield's lawyers began riding the circuit, traveling from town to town to try cases in front of equally itinerant judges. "You must find that dreary, Mr. Lincoln," Mary said one evening before her companion was to depart.
"Not at all, Miss Todd. I love it. We lawyers all travel about together, judges, too, and go at each other like cats and dogs in court. Then, when we're done for the day, we lounge about and swap tales.
I suppose the married lawyers don't take their wives. Too late, Mary hoped that Mr. Lincoln did not think she was insinuating anything. Mr. Lincoln, however, was too busy recalling the pleasures of the circuit to care.
No, Miss Todd, it's not a place for ladies. The roads can be awful, the lodgings aren't always the best, and, well, we men can be a little rough.
Perhaps you need some civilizing influences from the ladies.
I wouldn't want to be the lady who tried.
He rose just as Elizabeth made one of her rare glides into the room. It was a wee bit depressing, Mary reflected, to have a chaperone with so little to chaperone.
I'll see you in a few weeks, miss.
If this was a courtship, at least no one could call it a rushed one. She could understand, however, why courtship might not be the first thing on Mr. Lincoln's mind, for 1840 was an election year, with the Whig candidate, General William Henry Harrison, trying to unseat President Martin Van Buren. A Democrat had snidely remarked that Harrison, who was not in the spring of youth, would be content to sit in his log cabin with a pension and a barrel of hard cider. The jibe had backfired, for Harrison had seized upon it, dubbing himself the log cabin and hard cider candidate of the people, though his origins were far from humble. Springfield was in the thick of the election. The Whigs poured into town for their state convention in June, filling the streets with men sporting coonskin caps and pushing barrels of hard cider, the contents of which they were all too ready to consume. Mary, overcoming her chagrin that Henry Clay had not won the Whig nomination the year before, did her part to welcome the visitors, waving her handkerchief as they processed into the city, adorned with banners that she had helped sew. Mr. Lincoln, who himself was running for re-election to the Illinois House of Representatives, did his part in extolling Harrison's virtues. Even as she sat enthralled by his speech, Mary had to admit it was all a bit absurd, because Harrison, the scion of a wealthy Virginia family, had certainly not been born in a log cabin, and while he might have spent some time in one when he moved west, it most likely was not a terribly uncomfortable one. But Mr. Lincoln made it all sound quite plausible. Among the visitors the convention brought to Springfield was Judge David Todd, Mary's uncle. Naturally, he called to see his nieces, and after a couple of hours taking tea, no hard cider for a change, said, "Why don't you accompany me back to Missouri, Miss Todd, and stay a couple of months? Your cousin Anne would be delighted with your company." Mary readily agreed, for she loved travel, wearisome as it could be. Besides, her closest friend, Mercy, was back in Baltimore now, so the company of a young lady of her own age would be particularly pleasant and, well, perhaps her absence might be just what was needed to get Mr. Lincoln thinking more about her. So when Mr. Lincoln turned up a few days later and took his accustomed place, Mary said, "I will be taking to the circuit myself tomorrow, to Missouri, to visit Judge Todd and his family."
"How long will you stay, Miss Todd?"
He frowned slightly. "I do not know. I am told they live in a charming city." She smiled. "Perhaps I shall be tempted to change my residence permanently, sir."
"But you will miss all the goings on here," Mr. Lincoln said almost reproachfully.
Mary gave an elegant shrug.
"What will be, will be." "Well,"
he scooted slightly closer to her and leaned forward.
"Mary?"
Instinctively, Mary tipped her head a little bit backward, preparing for his kiss. Would it be an awkward one? Sadly, unlike dancing, she had no basis for comparison when kissing was concerned.
"Would you like me to send you the Springfield newspapers?"
Mary tipped her head forward again. "That would be very kind of you, Mr. Lincoln." She hoped she was not gritting her teeth. Mr. Lincoln did send the papers as promised, the Springfield paper and the Old Soldier, the latter issued by the Harrison campaign. To her surprise, she also received the Democratic paper, the Hickory Club, certainly not something that Mr. Lincoln would have sent her. Her suspicions about its origins were confirmed a day or so later when Stephen Douglas sent her a letter. It was a pleasant, chatty letter without an iota of romance in it, but it left her the distinct impression that the writer would not be averse to such a development if she encouraged it. Did she wish to? Certainly Mr. Douglas was agreeable enough and ambitious as well. Much to his credit, he did not stare at Mary as if she were a talking dog when she ventured to make a political observation. And whereas Mr. Lincoln often forgot the little politenesses to which ladies were accustomed, such as fetching lemonade at parties and bringing some candy or flowers when he visited, Mr. Douglas never did. Nothing led her to believe that she could not live happily enough with him. But his were not the only letters Mary received. A widower by the name of Edwin Webb, who had been another visitor to the Edwards house, wrote her a charming epistle, not so subtly advertising his merits as a husband, which were certainly considerable in the material way, although he left out the facts that he was some 20 years older than Mary and the father of 2 young children. Mary had not much enjoyed being a stepdaughter and was even less inclined to assume the role of stepmother, so she sent a polite reply and hoped the matter ended there. There was yet another suitor, this one in Missouri, Mr. Patrick Henry, who bore the name of his famous grandfather and did not allow the connection to be forgotten. He had wealth, talent, and good looks, everything except for humility. Mary decided she would have to forego the chance to bear the great-grandchildren of a patriot. So with these 3 unsatisfactory strings on her bow, she returned in September to Springfield. Mr. Lincoln had won his own re-election the month before, but with the presidential election drawing near, was campaigning for Harrison and had no time to savor his victory. Nor did he have time to spend in the Edwards' drawing room, so Mary saw him only when he gave speeches in public. This was just as well, she had to admit, for a summer lazing around in the Missouri heat, dining at her aunt's groaning table, and taking afternoon siestas had left her more than a little plump, and she would prefer Mr. Lincoln not to see her in this Falstaffian state. At last, election day arrived, and then ensued the long wait while the various states made their returns. Harrison lost Illinois. Would he meet a similar fate in other states? As the days passed, Mary took to visiting her friend Eliza Francis, a lady of middle age whose husband, Simeon, published the Springfield paper, the Sagamon Journal. If there was news to be had, her friend would have it. As she walked toward the Francis house on a chilly November afternoon, Mr. Lincoln's tall figure raced toward her.
"Miss Todd, we've won. Harrison will be the next president."
Mary squealed and clasped Mr. Lincoln's hand. He started but did not break free. Instead, he stood smiling down at her.
"I was on my way to bring you the news," he said.
"Really? I thought I had been quite forgotten these last few months."
"No."
"I am most gratified to hear that."
"It's strange. As soon as I heard the news, I knew I had to tell you straight away to get the full enjoyment out of it."
Still holding hands, they began walking, not toward the Francis house, not toward the Edwards house, but purely aimlessly. Mr. Lincoln took his hat off of his head and stared into it. Then he said to the hat,
"Marry me."
"What?"
"Was I unclear? I want to marry you, to live as man and wife."
"You've never even kissed me."
"Is that a prerequisite?"
"Most women would think so."
"Well, then."
Mr. Lincoln clapped his hat back onto his head, pulled her against him, and stopped. He was not an awkward kisser, nor was he in a hurry. Nor was Mary, even as she reflected on the splendid show the pair of them were putting on.
"Now,"
Mr. Lincoln said when he at last straightened up,
"now, Molly, will you marry me?"
His use of this familiar form of the name was as good as another man's getting upon his knees. "Yes," said Mary, "absolutely." When they stopped kissing and began to work out the details, they decided to keep their engagement secret, as neither liked the idea of being the subject of the town's gossip. Besides, Mr. Lincoln told her, it might have to be a long engagement, as he could not support Mary in the style to which she had become accustomed.
or anything close," he added. "I don't expect a fine house or a carriage or anything like that. But you do expect a house. Well, and you'd have to do without servants. How many slaves does your father have?" "Well, there's Mammy Sally. She's getting up there, poor thing. And Peter, and 12. Of course, our family is large, so... But I do almost everything for myself at my sister's house, except to cook and clean, of course. But I could learn to do those things." Mr. Lincoln glanced at Mary's hands, clad in immaculate kid gloves. "We'd best wait," he said dryly. Soon after Mary's engagement, Miss Matilda Edwards, a cousin of Ninian's, came from Alton, Illinois, on an extended visit to Springfield. She and Mary, Elizabeth was fond of pointing out, were creatures of entirely different styles. Matilda was blonde, ethereal, and tall, while Mary was brunette, plumpish, and short, and it soon became clear that male Springfield, in the winter of 1840-41, preferred Matilda's style to Mary's. Night after night, the drawing room filled to receive male callers, ostensibly to see both girls, but in reality to gaze at Matilda. Joshua Speed, the genteel Kentuckian who had left his plantation home behind to open a general store in Springfield, and who, at least when compared to Mr. Lincoln, was a virtual Casanova, was the worst of all. He would plant himself in an armchair, tip his head back, and float amongst the heavens as Miss Edwards played and sang in what a woman knew, and surely any rational man would have to admit, was a slightly croaking voice. When Mr. Speed came, his best friend and lodger, Mr. Lincoln, came as well. Mary was grateful at first for this. It allowed her the opportunity to spend some time with her fiancé without attracting the notice of her sister. But as December wore on, even Mr. Lincoln's eyes began to turn in Miss Edwards's direction ever so slightly. It would have been deeply satisfying to dislike Miss Edwards for this, but as best as Mary could tell, Matilda was perfectly unconscious of the havoc she was wreaking among the male hearts of Springfield. She received each and every one of her callers with the same bland, sweet smile and, when they departed, settled down to her tract or her knitting with no sign of wishing they would return. Only once did Mary see her blush, and that was when Mary caught her rereading a letter in the bedroom they now shared. The envelope bore the name of Newton Strong, the gentleman who had escorted her to Springfield. Had Mary and Matilda been rivals, they would have been very miserable indeed, for not only did they receive visits together, they received invitations together, including one from John Harden, a connection of Mary's who asked the young women to visit him and his wife in Jacksonville over Christmas. Lest Springfield's eligible bachelors lose the opportunity of mooning over Matilda for a few days in December, they were invited too. "I do hope you will remember you are a Todd," Elizabeth informed Mary as she packed. "What on earth does that mean?" "Mr. Lincoln will be there, will he not? I see him with you when he's here. I hear the gossip about the two of you. He should have made his intentions clear by now, even written to our father. I know that where he comes from, men sometimes get it backward. They get a child on a girl and then marry her. He needs to know you're not that kind, and you need to remember it yourself." "For heaven's sake!" Mary stamped her foot for good measure. "Mr. Lincoln has been nothing but gentlemanly toward me. More so, I must say, than certain men I could name when they are in their cups." "Who? Mary, if any man has behaved disrespectfully to you, you must let Mr. Edwards know." "I'll not pass on tales that may be mere malicious gossip, sister, and I will thank you to do the same with Mr. Lincoln." In fact, she knew of no such ill behavior by any visitor to her sister's house, but it was delicious to see Elizabeth worry. The Harden house was stuffed full of humanity. Mary and Matilda found themselves sharing a bed with Mr. Harden's pert little sister, Martinette, visiting from Kentucky, yet another girl in search of a husband, Mary supposed. "The three M's," Martinette said as they settled into their bed.
Crowded as it was, Mary had no complaints as it was freezing outside and chilly inside, even with a fire.
Matilda, could you scoot over just a bit? Think of it. We could be one of the poor men having to share a bed with Mr. Lincoln.
Martinette giggled.
But I bet some ladies wouldn't mind that.
Matilda, who was pious, let out a disapproving noise, and Mary preserved a judicious silence until Martinette moved to her next topic.
My brother has a surprise for us tomorrow.
Oh, will you tell us what it is?
No, as it wouldn't be a surprise then,
Martinette said predictably. After everyone consumed a hearty breakfast the next morning, Sarah Hardin rose, two metal objects in her hand. It's freezing outside, so what is it perfect for?
Staying by the fire, Mary suggested.
No, my dear, ice skating. It's the rage in England. The Queen loves it. Remember the delightful scene where Mr. Pickwick goes ice skating?
And falls in, my dear,
John Hardin said.
That's when he's sliding, not skating, and our men have tested the pond. An elephant could walk over it, they swear. Now, I have plenty of skates for anyone who's daring enough to try. Who is?
We are, said Mr. Webb's son and daughter in unison.
Well, I certainly am, said Orville Browning.
And so am I.
Mary lifted her hand, then turned to Mr. Lincoln. If you will assist me, sir. Sarah Hardin winked, anticipating Mr. Lincoln's answer.
These skates will fit even your feet, Mr. Lincoln.
With this settled, the party bundled up and walked to the pond. Martinette, who had been on skates before, managed a pretty turn or two on the ice, while the Webb children, the two sweet objections, as Mary had dubbed them, fell down as often as they stood up, but shrieked joyously the entire time they did so. Matilda did not venture onto the pond, perhaps to the disappointment of the men who would have welcomed a glimpse of her stockinged legs, but did the next best thing by standing by the pond, looking her most fetching, with her cheeks rosy from the cold and her dainty hands snuggled inside a muff. Her arm in Mr. Lincoln's, Mary shuffled onto the ice. Awkward on a dance floor, Mr. Lincoln proved startlingly sure-footed on skates, and with him to prop her up, Mary grew daring enough to glide forward. And what a treat to have an excuse to lean against him. If only the sweet objections did not insist on skating so close to him, for children adored Mr. Lincoln, it would have been perfect. Then a terrible shriek filled the air, and Mary and Mr. Lincoln turned to see Matilda Edwards' golden head slipping below the ice. No human being had ever been rescued so quickly, Mary was to reflect later. In seconds, every male inhabitant of the Hardin house collected around the dainty little hole into which poor Matilda had slipped. Even Mr. Lincoln released Mary and, with two long glides, was at the scene, leaving Mary to capsize onto her bottom and, unable to right herself without assistance, to crawl ignominiously to the edge of the pond. By the time she reached it, the men already had Matilda free and were bearing her to the house. There was nothing for Mary to do but pry off her skates, herd the Webb children, quite forgotten by the adults, off the pond, and grimly follow the procession. Sarah Hardin wasted no time putting Matilda to bed and dosing her with brandy. As far as Mary could tell, she was none the worse for wear, except perhaps for the effects of the brandy, which sent her fast asleep. But the party was dampened nonetheless for it. John Hardin said that he wished he had never bought the blasted skates. Martinette, who turned out to be the culprit who had persuaded Matilda to step onto the ice, was so lugubrious in bewailing her guilt that she, too, had to be helped to bed. Mr. Browning hoped that Matilda was not from consumptive stock, and Mr. Lincoln said nothing but stared mournfully out the window. It was like a funeral without a corpse. In the late afternoon, Matilda came downstairs. If anything, she looked prettier after her ordeal,
Bundled up in the most comfortable chair, she accepted mug after mug of hot cocoa from a penitent martinet as the men praised her courage and the women urged her to stay by the fire so she would not catch cold. Mr. Lincoln's pained face broke into a smile, and he regaled the crowd with his best stories, at which Matilda laughed gently as befitted an invalid. So when the stony-hearted Mr. Webb, who said he had had several plunges into the ice as a boy and had lived to tell about them, turned his attention to Mary, what else could she do but talk to him? She'd always liked him perfectly well. It wasn't his fault that he did not set her heart to fluttering. Still, when the party broke up for the evening, Matilda being helped up the stairs, although she hardly needed it, Mary lingered in the parlor, hoping that Mr. Lincoln might want a word with her. But he followed the men to his sleeping quarters, and Mary went in silence to her own bedchamber. The men returned to Springfield the next day to attend the legislature, but Mary and Matilda lingered a couple of days in Jacksonville, hoping for snow and a sleigh ride. As the former never came, they rode back by coach to Springfield, for the tiny train that puttered its way to Jacksonville once each day had not yet been extended to the fledgling capital. On New Year's Day, 1841, Mary was sitting in the parlor when she heard a knock at the front door, followed by the appearance of Mr. Lincoln. "Why, I wish you a happy New Year, sir, and"—she lowered her voice and smiled—"what a better way to start a new year than by planning a wedding. I've been reading cookery books and am growing quite domesticated, Mary. Now, I know you consider me a spoiled creature, but really, sir, you underestimate us Todd girls. Why, my sister, Mrs. Wallace, is still lodging in the Globe Tavern, and she never complains of the quarters, even after becoming a mother. We have the capacity to make do, sir. Mary, I am sure you don't want a grand ceremony. I don't want one either. Just a few friends and family.
We can't do this. We can't marry.
Why on earth not? Mary shot up to her full 5'2". Has Mr. Edwards forbid it? The nerve! I am of age, and I will marry whom I please. Why, we'll elope.
No, Mary, it's not him. It's me. I can't marry you.
Mary sat back down. You're in love with Matilda Edwards, she said flatly.
No, I've hardly spoken a word to her.
When did that stop anyone?
Be that as it may, I'm not in love with her.
I'm not in love with anyone else.
You are angry that I paid so much attention to Mr. Webb the other night. Maybe I was flirting a wee bit. The deceiver deceived. I meant no harm, truly. He was the only person not acting ridiculous about Matilda, and he is a perfectly agreeable man, and—
It's not Webb. I like Webb. Why would you, being friendly to him, distress me? Mary, it's me. I can't marry you. I can't marry anyone.
Mary reviewed all the reasons a man might not marry. A loathsome disease, unnatural behavior, financial distress, and decided to focus on the least frightening one. Mr. Lincoln, I told you again and again that I don't expect to live in high style.
I can keep a wife. It's me. Mary, will you listen to me? Every time I think of marriage, my blood runs cold. I'm not ready. I don't know if I ever will be, but I do know that I'm not ready now.
Do you love me? Mr. Lincoln gazed at her for a long time.
I don't know, he said. You're pretty, and you're smart and lively, but
then end it.
He began pacing around the room. But we were engaged. I made a promise, perhaps.
Lawyer that he was, no doubt he was worried that she might sue him for breach of promise to marry, not that she would humiliate herself by taking the witness stand as a spurned bride. End it, she repeated. I will not hold you to a promise that you do not wish to keep. I will release you from our engagement. I will even put it in writing.
She went to the desk, supplied with ink and paper as if awaiting such an occasion, and scrawled something, anything, to the effect of what she had told Mr. Lincoln, then held out the finished product to him. Evidently, it satisfied his lawyer's mind, for he took it and stuffed it into his coat pocket.
"I didn't want to hurt you, Miss Todd."
"Yet you managed that quite competently." She turned away, conscious of the tears beginning to run down her face. "I did not write this in the letter, but know this. My feelings for you have not changed. Should you come to your senses and recognize how good we would be for each other, I will be here."
"Oh, Mary."
He pulled her on his knee and kissed her as passionately as he had kissed her when he had proposed marriage. It was she who disengaged herself, marched to the parlor door, and flung it wide open. "You have this all backward, Mr. Lincoln. Goodbye." Of course, she cried all night. Who wouldn't? She refused dinner, claiming indisposition, and when poor Matilda came bearing a plate of food, she threw it across the room, though she did wait until Matilda had left, at least. What could she do? Springfield, and especially her own little circle, was too small for her and Mr. Lincoln's estrangement to go unnoticed, and while few, if any, might have suspected their engagement, Mary had no doubt that word would go out soon over it being broken. But she would have to brave it out, because going back to Lexington was unthinkable. Her sister Anne would take her place in Springfield, something she had been hinting at in her letters already, and Mary would return to her maiden's bedroom a confirmed spinster, growing peculiar and set in her ways as her younger half-sister sprouted up and began attracting suitors. She might as well start teaching school, acquire a multitude of cats, and be done with it. In Springfield, at least she had some possibilities. Not that any of them meant anything to her. Of course, after bathing her eyes the next morning and picking up the broken crockery, she had to tell Elizabeth. "You know, I really don't think the two of you would have been happy together," Elizabeth said. Was she fighting back a smile? "Mr. Lincoln is certainly a talented lawyer, and it's admirable how far he's come in life, but he's just not your sort, Mary, and never will be. That would have become all too apparent when you began entertaining, if he could even give you a suitable home in which to entertain. He's, well, he's a plebeian, my dear. And Mary, there's something else that's always made me wary. Have you ever seen him go to church? Certainly he goes to none that any of our circle attends. I have given him the benefit of the doubt, thinking he might be a member of some primitive sect, but he never speaks of going anywhere. I fear he is a non-believer." "Oh, pshaw, he is a spiritual man, and that is what counts. And as for his origins, they are the only thing common about him. I can see great things in him." "You certainly are eager to defend a man who treated you so shabbily. I won't have anyone speaking ill of my future husband, for he will be when he comes to his senses." She had spoken reflexively, but really, what other explanation could there be other than some peculiarity in Mr. Lincoln's character? It was another reason, indeed, the best reason, to remain in Springfield. When he returned to normal, she would have to be on the spot. As January wore on, it became apparent that Mr. Lincoln was suffering dreadfully. The day after he ended, or as Mary liked to think of it, suspended, their engagement, he failed to turn up for a vote at the legislature, and by mid-January, he had collapsed entirely, taking to his bed as if he, not Mary, had been the spurned one. Elizabeth, who made it her business to keep current with the gossip about Mr. Lincoln, informed Mary that he was all but a lunatic and that only Joshua Speed and Dr. Anson Henry, who was both Mr. Lincoln's friend and a physician, were allowed to tend to him. They would not even trust him around his dinner knife for fear that he might end it all then and there. While Mr. Lincoln lay confined in his bladeless room, visitors trooped to the Edwards house, eager to see the two young ladies who had brought him to his ruin. In one version of events, poor Matilda's stony heart had laid Mr. Lincoln low. In another version,
Mary's coquettishness had made him, literally, insanely jealous. For either lady to leave town or even to refuse company would have driven the gossips into a frenzy. So they sat side by side in the drawing room, smiling grimly, chattering inanely about any subject they could find that was as far from Mr. Lincoln as possible. After about a week or so of this, Mr. Lincoln was seen once again in the streets of Springfield, looking pale and thin and gloomy, but acting, everyone agreed, perfectly sane. The gossip receded, and life went back to normal, except that Mr. Lincoln no longer appeared at the Edwardses or scarcely any place else that he was likely to meet Mary, which meant, in essence, that he avoided any social gathering where ladies might be present. In turn, Mary avoided the places where she might run into him, such as the homes of his married friends. Yet she made it her business to keep informed of his doings. She felt his sorrow from afar when President Harrison, whom he had worked so hard to elect, fell sick on the day of his inauguration in March and died just a month later. All for naught. She felt less compassion for her former betrothed, however, when Elizabeth, always eager to pass on such things to her, informed her that Mr. Lincoln, who took his meals at the home of William and Eliza Butler, had taken an interest in Eliza's young sister, Sarah Rickard. At the time Mary had arrived in Springfield, Sarah had been a mere girl in pantalettes, but in the past year her hems had dropped, and she had developed a noticeable bosom. "He's even taken her to see the babes in the woods," Elizabeth told her. "The first time he's been seen in female company. The Butlers are good friends of his, and they took good care of him while he was indisposed. He eats with them every day. No doubt he thinks of the child as a little sister. Look at what he took her to, a nursery tale." Still, Mary kept a close eye on the girl as she sashayed around town, swishing her long skirts and wearing brooches that drew the eye to her fine new bosom. It was a relief to see her drooping not at all when Mr. Lincoln left in the summer to visit Joshua Speed, who had returned to his family's Kentucky plantation after the death of his father, although Mary also felt indignant on Lincoln's behalf. Did not the silly chit appreciate him? The months wore on. Mr. Lincoln returned, by all accounts, more cheerful, not that Mary saw that in person. Mercy Levering returned to Springfield, married her beau, James Conkling, and promptly turned into a staid matron. Matilda Edwards, having turned down several proposals on the grounds that the grooms were too dissolute, returned to her home in Alton, from which in due time she announced her upcoming marriage to Mr. Strong. The little train that chugged to Jacksonville finally made its way to Springfield. Back in Lexington, Mary had acquired two more half-sisters, little Elodie in 1840 and little Kitty in the fall of 1841. Mary thought of going to Lexington to see them, but decided against it. When she came back, it would be as Mrs. Abraham Lincoln, not as Miss Mary Todd. Not that Mr. Lincoln was cooperating, she had to acknowledge, as 1841 turned into 1842, and yet more of her friends tumbled into matrimony, the latest being Joshua Speed, now firmly settled on his Kentucky plantation. Men still called on her, but to talk, not to court. Even Mr. Webb had given up. Then, as summer began to descend upon Springfield, her friend, Mrs. Francis, invited her to spend the evening with just a few friends, as she put it. This suited Mary well enough, as she was beginning to tire of large gatherings, and what other parlor in Springfield smelled so pleasantly of newsprint? But when she arrived, she found herself the only person present other than her hostess. "Am I frightfully early? Did I mistake the time?"
"No, you're quite right."
She led Mary to the parlor and began to chat, but her usual lively conversation seemed strained. And where were the other guests? Then a knock sounded, and Mrs. Francis sprang up, even though she had a servant to answer her door. After a moment, she re-entered, leading in another guest who came to a halt in the doorway. "Miss Todd."
"Sir," Mary said weakly.
"Come in, come in," Eliza said. Mr. Lincoln obeyed, but remained gaping at Mary.
It is no accident that I brought the two of you here. Mr. Lincoln, sit on the sofa. Yes, beside Miss Todd. There. Now, isn't this pleasant? Here's my husband to balance things out. A Sagamon journal in his hand, Simeon Francis nodded at them as he entered the room. How is your meddling going, my dear? 'Tis too early to tell, but I have hope. Look at the two of them. She beamed at Mary and Mr. Lincoln, sitting rigidly side by side. I don't see how they've stood to be apart all this time. May I ask what this is about? Mary said. Yes, you may, and I'm glad one of you can speak at least. Now look, whatever quarrel the two of you had, you must make it up and be friends again. I know that you're fond of Mr. Lincoln, Mary, and I know that you, Mr. Lincoln, are fond of Mary. Why, you're perfect for each other. It just kills my soul to see the two of you moping apart. Oh, don't tell me that you haven't moped. Now, Sim and I will leave the room, and I expect to hear some conversation emanating from here. With a cheery wave, she departed, followed by Simeon Francis, who shrugged and gave Mr. Lincoln a sympathetic glance on his way out. Mr. Lincoln arose and stared out the window while Mary studied her hands. Finally, Lincoln spoke.
I've not stopped loving you. I've tried.
Well, that's flattering, I suppose, Mr. Lincoln, but may I ask why you've tried?
I don't know.
I do hope your arguments in court are more satisfactory than that.
Lord, I've missed that tongue of hers,
Mr. Lincoln said to the window. But you do love me, it seems. If I recall, you weren't so certain of that before.
I do believe I'm certain of that now.
He continued his survey of the street for a few minutes, then turned.
I've discussed this with Dr. Henry.
You've made a medical case of me, Mr. Lincoln.
I near ran mad when I stopped seeing you. Guilt and shame. Anyway, as I told him, it's not the way I act toward women normally. I have a story to tell on myself, one that only a handful of people know of. I had a good friend in New Salem, a married lady. She had a sister in Kentucky, a handsome gal. My married friend got it into her head that I should marry said sister, and like a blockhead, I agreed. I'd met her when she paid a short visit to New Salem and liked her well enough, and my friend and her husband had been so kind and hospitable to me when I was a poor newcomer to that area. Well, I felt I'd be ungrateful if I refused. So the lady came on consignment, as it were, and she was just as I remembered, except that there was quite a bit more of her, a good 30 pounds more. Mary sucked her breath in, wondering if she could lace her stays a little tighter. So you rejected her? No, I did as I promised. I courted her, wrote letters to her. By then I was off with the legislature, paid her visits. She had a fine face, a good wit, a good education, all the requisites. Finally, I realized it was now or never. I proposed, and she turned me down flat. Fool that I was, I proposed again, thinking perhaps she was being coy, and she turned me down as flat as a squashed frog. I should have been relieved. I suppose I was relieved. But when she said no, I almost fell in love with her then and there. A matter of wanting what we can't have, I guess.
And perhaps not wanting what we can have.
I think you've hit it, Miss Todd. And so this is what I suggest. That we resume seeing each other again, but leave the question of marriage open until I can resolve my confounded doubts as to whether I can ever steel myself for matrimony.
Mr. Lincoln, your plan is sensible, but you forget how I am placed as a woman. I cannot see you indefinitely with no hope of being your wife. Either we must marry or we must end it,
anything else would give rise to gossip that I am your mere paramour.
I do understand it, which is why I suggest more, that we meet secretly. Perhaps here, with Simeon and wife having meddled, how can they complain? And I suggest that by the end of the year, if we are not engaged, we end it. No need to keep polishing a bit of tin in the hope that it's going to become gold. In the meantime, should you come to prefer anyone else, and I am taking a chance there because I am well aware that there are many who have more to offer, you are free to drop me. No hard feelings, and not a word of reproach on my end.
When Mary remained silent, he said,
I'm not good at guessing what any woman is thinking, but I believe I can give it a try in your case. You're thinking that you've never heard anything less romantic in your life, that we might be discussing a mere business arrangement.
That thought had occurred to me.
Molly, if I may call you that again, it's because I love and respect you that I'm asking this of you. Give us time. 6 months is all I ask. Time enough for me to know my mind, and time enough for you to decide whether you're making a good bargain. There I am, with the business terms again, so I think I'll stop before I dig a deeper hole for myself.
I agree to your terms, Mr. Lincoln. You are right. They do not set my heart aflutter, but I know you to be a fair and decent man, and I take them in the right spirit. But what happened to the young lady who refused you?
Went back to Kentucky and married quite well. So you could say she got the better of the bargain, Molly.
The Francises agreed to make their parlor available for Mary and Mr. Lincoln's meetings. Once or twice a week or so, Mary went to visit Mrs. Francis, and Mr. Lincoln would stroll over to the newspaper office and then, quite casually, make his way to the Francis house next door to pay his respects to the editor's lady. For anywhere from a few minutes to a solid hour, the couple was left undisturbed. Depending upon the time they had and their mood, they talked, kissed, or did both. If Elizabeth wondered about the new intensity of Mary's friendship for Mrs. Francis, she said nothing, nor did she comment on the fact that prospective suitors no longer flocked to the Edwards house now that Matilda had gone home. She seemed, in fact, quite reconciled to Mary becoming a permanent fixture in her house, a useful old maid who helped the children with their lessons, shared her duties as hostess, and wielded her needle to good effect. When not secretly meeting Mr. Lincoln or old maiding it in the parlor, Mary passed the time with a new friend, Miss Julia Jane, who, unlike most ladies, shared her interest in politics. Happy as they were to spend an afternoon studying Godey's ladies' book, it was the Sagamon Journal that was their favored reading, and never more so than that summer when a letter from Rebecca appeared ridiculing James Shields, the state auditor. He was a frequent visitor at the Edwards house and was attentive to Mary, as he was to everyone in skirts, even the parlor maid, but labored under the hopeless liability of being a Democrat. After the appearance of the letter, he had fumed at every gathering he attended, giving the women hope that there would be a sequel to the missive. "And here it is," Julia said, waving the newspaper in the air as she came into the parlor on a fine September day. They spread out the paper on a table and giggled over it. They had a sort of gathering there one night among the grandees they called a fair. All the gals about town was there, and all the handsome widows and married women finicking about, trying to look like gals, tied as tight in the middle and puffed out at both ends like bundles of fodder that hadn't been stacked yet, but wanted stacking pretty bad. And then they had tables all round the house, covered over with baby caps and pincushions and 10,000 such little knick-knacks, trying to sell 'em to the fellows that were bowing and scraping and congeering about 'em. I looked in at the window, and there was this same fellow, Shields, floating about on the air, without heft or earthly substance, just like a lock of cat fur where cats had been fighting. He was paying his money to this one and that one and other one and suffering greatly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.